Nicolas Jaar certainly was an early starter. By the time he was 17, he'd released his debut on Brooklyn-based label Wolf & Lamb. By the time he'd hit 22, he'd already become a firm part of the establishment in terms of house and techno music. With the unusually slow tempo of his beats and his very own approach to sound design, he's managed to prove that ecstatic, intense moments can occur on the dance floor without going above the 120 BPM mark.
I think that making something that doesn't necessarily have a context, like a trend context or a zeitgeist context, is impossible. I mean, it's always going to be linked to a certain time period. But I do think that if you go into the studio and you just really do whatever, like you don't go and try to make this type of track or that type, if you just go and like try to have fun and complete chaos, complete craziness, then if it's true, then it'll probably stand the test of time, I think. I was once thinking about the fact that people were calling my music sparse, because I never thought of it this way. And then I was like looking into my sessions, and I have like 70 tracks, you know? Like there's a lot of stuff actually in there, but I guess you don't hear it. Or I guess maybe unless you're not listening for the small sounds or this or that, you just hear a couple of things. And that's interesting, because sparse can also be a subjective thing. It can seem sparse when it's not, and it can seem complicated when it's not also. It's this kind of double thing. Every sound that is in a song has its own separate track and has its own EQing and has its own place in the mix and has its own send and effects, right? And sometimes I laugh at myself because it maybe serves no purpose whatsoever. But at the same time, there's something to be said about specificity. And, you know, if you have every sound sounding exactly the way you want it to sound, maybe what you want it to say will be also understood better. But I don't know this. Maybe not. I have no clue. Is like a good analog EQ. That's really like what I use. I really love that. And maybe it serves little purpose. Maybe it's just me being kind of nerdy and stupid with these machines. But I'm so much happier and more comfortable when I know that it sounds exactly like what I want. And then I can actually feel like I can, you know, in the studio, do a good piece of music. I think tempo is a very interesting tool. I love going from, you know, 60 BPM to 130. I like using it as a spectrum of sound of, you know, here's what another tool, another instrument. Tempo is an instrument, at least I think so, to me. It liberates me to know that a song can be any tempo. And an amazing thing to do in the studio if you get bored of a song is, you know, if a lot of the stuff is MIDI, you know, you just put it at 15 BPM and listen to it. You can just get the most beautiful stuff. You know, it'll just be like a big kick and then nothing for 3 seconds and then a chord that lasts like a minute, you know. I mean, it can help you get out of what you do. I do this actually a lot. It's very, I mean, people who have watched me make music are like, what the hell's he doing now? He's listening to an hour's worth of stupid little, you know, noises, but it actually helps me understand where we are in the song. It's almost like making yourself tiny next to the big song, you know, and you're there, you're looking at the huge kick and then the, you know what I'm saying? Like it's, I think it helps, and this is another way in which the tempo is an instrument in a way. Studio, I tend to try to think of nothing and see where I am at in here and in here. And because of the fact that a live setting is always in a different place with different people, with different sound systems, you're forced to think of so much more practical things when you're playing live, that they're completely different things for me. When I finish a song, I tend to not think, oh, how am I going to play it live? I tend to think, oh, I finished a song. And I'm just happy that I finished the song. When I have to play it live, I completely change everything about the song, usually. I don't think there's one song that I play that sounds just like what the song actually sounds like in its, you know, product form. One thing that I actually change the most is the bass lines. Yeah, I think I make a new bass line every time I play for one song or another, just because it changes so much. You know, having the same song but a different bass line will change the whole kind of rhythm of the song. And that's exciting, that keeps it exciting. It's like a fast way, in a way, like a cheap way to make the whole song feel exciting again.
You used to check the weather, now you stop that. You used to look the time, now you stop that. You used to wear red, now you wear white. What happened all the time, it happened all the time. Replace the word space with a dream and forget it. Space is only noise if you can see. Grab a calculator and fix yourself. Grab a calculator and fix yourself. Read the news, baby, read the news. Watch your clock, baby, watch your clock. Watch the weather. It's all together, you can see.
What making the set means for me is more like getting new material, you know, maybe finding in the internet some weird atmospheric sound that I'm feeling today, or maybe recording something. And I try to insert that into what I'm going to do tonight, because if I'm playing with the same elements, even though I'm completely improvising inside of them, I can get bored with myself, so I try to every time do something different. In terms of the improvisational element that exists in every single live performance that me and the band do, we don't know what we're going to play before we play it, before 2-3 minutes before. And sometimes I even surprise the band and start playing a song that we all like but that we don't always play right in the middle, and we all get excited because we didn't know that this was going to happen. So I like that type of stuff. It's more psychological improvisation, if anything, because if I start playing the song and I look at them and they're both laughing, you know, because they're like, oh, we're going to do this now, you know? So I like that type of improvisation, an improvisation that is also a conversation with the people that I'm playing with. Another way that I try to improvise is with what the crowd is actually doing. So for example, a couple of shows ago, the crowd, we got on stage and they started just clapping, you know, in a certain rhythm. And we never start playing at this tempo. They were doing like 1:15, but we were like, okay, so I tapped it and then I put a clap that went clap, 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 just like what they were doing. And we started like that and slowly slowed it back down. And so it's interesting to do this, and it's exciting for me, because when you're playing for 4 months in a row, I would say after maybe a month, you start wanting to, you know, change what you're doing. I want to be able to give exactly what was meant to be given. And it's not so easy to do it every time, and it's so frustrating when I can't do it. It really hurts me. When you know, you go there and you try to give your best, and then the sound is just not that good, it's very sad. It's weird, because I tell myself that I have more freedom. It's weird, it doesn't make much sense, but I'd say, okay, so the sound sucks, so we're gonna do whatever. And usually when the sound is bad, I try to, you know, go a little, use distortion, and I tell Dave, my guitar player, to play harder. Because when the sound is bad, what gets through is passion, distortion, force, certain things that are not really part of my music. But we have to do that, because or else the sound system will not give what we are trying to give.
See the light, right about time, see the faith. You ain't got no distress in bigger ways. No more time for me and you. Take me on the road, baby, you do. Take me back in time, say goodbye. Oh, baby, cigarette for me and you. This is the time, the time, the time. The time for me and you.
Mm-hmm.